Hello everyone, this is Dr. Sharif El-Gamal, and today we are going to have a very important video about design of reinforced concrete beams. This is required by many of you to include such a video, and within this video we'll learn how to transfer loads from two-way slabs or one-way slabs on beams, how to use this load, concentrated load or trapezoidal load, to draw the bending moment diagram of the beam, and then we will design different section of this beam, and we'll finally get the reinforcement, and we'll see the detailing and sections of reinforcement. So the first thing we start with transferring load from slabs to beams. This will include trapezoidal loads, triangle loads, and even uniform load from one-way slabs. After doing that, we will calculate the bending moment and shear force diagrams. Then we'll design of a beam with all checks. Then finally, we'll go to drawing of reinforcement. So let's start by knowing how to transfer loads from slabs to beams. To do that, we need to differentiate between one-way slabs and two-way slabs. In one-way slabs, the longest band divided by the shortest band is greater than 2. And in this case, the load will go in the short direction of the slab to the two long beams and will be divided to two uniform loads, as you can see here. This will be the area of the slab supported on the beam. The height here will be the shortest band divided by 2. If you want to get the uniform load here, we just multiply the length Lx over 2 multiplied by N, which is the load on the slab in kilonewton per meter square. We get this load as uniform load, kilonewton per meter. If you want to get it as a concentrated load directly, just you multiply this area by the load in kilonewton per meter square. So the resultant here will be as kilonewton. So this is in the case of one-way slab. For the two-way slab, we have the Ly over Lx, or the long side divided by the short side, is less than or equals 2. In this case, we have to divide the slab into two triangles and two trapezoidal loads. We go with an angle 45. When they meet here, we just make a horizontal line. Then we have two trapezoids will be loaded on the long beams, and the two triangles will be loaded on the short beams. And then we can get the area here. If you multiply the area by the ultimate load on the slab, you can get it as a concentrated load. If you want to get this load as uniform load, multiply the N by the height, Lx over 2, so it will give you as kilonewton per meter. The same will be in the case of triangle load, the same height, and we can use in this case area 2. We went through all of this earlier, and when we were designing beams in part 1, you can check my previous videos to learn more about this. So let's now go to a new step and how to get the maximum bending moment and shear forces on beams. Okay, and this will be outlined in case if you have one span or any structure which is statically determined structures. So this is, let's assume that we have a span with L, simply supported beam. The load is coming from one-way slab, which is W kilonewton per meter. So to get the maximum moment, let's get the resultant. So the resultant here will be F. This F equals W times the span, the load in kilonewton per meter multiplied by L in meter. So the resultant will be kilonewton. If you want to get the reactions, and this will be the maximum shear, so it will be F divided by 2 or 0.5F. If you want to get the maximum moment at the middle, it will be FL over 8, or the famous equation, which is maximum moment under uniform load, is WL square over 8. This one, we can use it when we want to design a beam supporting a uniform load. The moment is WL square over 8, and the shear is WL over 2 or 0.5F. Now let's go to the second case when you have a triangle load supported on a beam. Assume this load is W kilonewton per meter. So if you want to get the resultant, we can multiply F here equals to the height of the triangle times L times half. So it is 1 over 2 W times L. This will be the resultant force here. Half of this force will be the shear, so the shear will be 0.5F, and the moment equals FL over 6, or in case this case, WL square over 12. So in case if you have a triangle load on simply support span and you want to calculate the maximum moment, you can get it from FL over 6, and the maximum shear is 0.5F, where F is the resultant of the force. The last one is the case when we have trapezoidal load. When you have a trapezoidal load, this is usually comes from two-way slabs, which is not a square slab. So you will have triangle and trapezoidal load. Again, you need to get the value of the resultant of the load. This resultant of the load here equals the average of the two lenses multiplied by the height, which is W in this case, or we can get it as W times L minus A. This load kilonewton per meter multiplied by this length minus this length, assuming that we took this small triangle and we put it here. So it will be W times L minus A. This will be the resultant. The second point to get the Vmax, again, as usual, the maximum shear will be F over 2 because it is symmetric, so 0.5F. And to get the maximum moment, we can get it from this equation. Within this video, we'll be learning how to use this trapezoidal to get a real moment on a beam with a cantilever. So we will have two cases, concentrated loads, how to transfer concentrated loads to a beam, and also how to draw the bending moment shear, design, making detailing, and so on. To learn this, our example that we will use today, it will be this plan. In this plan, we have three or four main beams, other beams in the other directions. And if you take a section here, this is showing the main beam B1 that we need to design today. So this B1 beam is supported on a column here, another column here, and this part is a cantilever. Okay, so it is one span with a cantilever. Okay, this beam is supporting slabs and also is supporting the secondary beams at the end of the cantilever here, because the load of the secondary beam should be coming as concentrated load on the end of the cantilever of the main beam B1. Okay, so what is required here? Required to design B1, we are going to design B1, including the span and the cantilever. We will design only here to limit because of the we don't want to make a long video. We'll design for flexure. The checking for shear will be keeping this later. So we'll design for flexure and we'll check only for the deflection. Then we will draw the reinforcement design and showing the detailing of reinforcement. So the data given here. So the slab live load is given as 3 kN/m². Floor finishes and ceiling loads as 1.5 kN/m². Also we assumed here 1 hour fire resistance and mild exposure. FCU is given at 30 and F yield is 460 megapascal. And also it is given that the slab thickness is 175 millimeter. Columns, all these columns are 250 by 250. And here it is saying neglect the beam self weight. So when we calculate loads, we will calculate loads and we will neglect the self weight of the beams. If it is not neglected, it is easy to be calculated. And we have learned that in a previous video, you can check them, how to get the self weight of the beams, how to calculate the wall loads, all of that you can check in earlier videos about design of beams. So let's start making our design. The first step is we need to get the dimensions. We need to assume good dimensions of the beam. We call this step as initial proportioning. This beam is a span with a cantilever. So for a beam with a cantilever or overhang, we assume the H equal span over 12. Of course, you have a table in the code, the BS code. You can use it also to get the effective depths, but also you can get the H by, for case of continuous beams, it will be span over 12 to span over 14. This will give you a very reasonable values for the total H of the beam. So in this case, because continuous from only one side, we get the span divided by 12. The span is the main span of the main beam, 7,000 millimeter divided by 12. So the result will be 583 millimeter. We cannot use it like that. We have to round it to a reasonable value. So here we round it up to 600 millimeter. Okay, so we got the edge of the beam is 600 millimeter. We need also to get the width of the beam. The width is ranging from h over 2 to h over 3. So it will be from 300 to 200. You can assume it any of those. I choose here to take something in between 250 millimeter. And also when you have this value, also keep it rounded to the nearest 25 millimeters. Don't take a value like 249 or 248. This is not practical. Okay, so once we did that, we got the H, we got the B. We now need to get the effective depth. To get the effective depth from table 3.3, we go for mild exposure with C30. From this table, we can get the cover is 25 millimeter. And also we can get the cover from the fire resistance. This is table 3.4 for 1 hour fire resistance. And this is beam, so it is 20 millimeter. So we got two values. The first value is 25, the other value is 20. We take the larger of the two values. So the nominal cover in this case will be 25, which is the larger of the two values. Once we did that, we assume 20 millimeter diameter of the bars. We assume stirrups. I assumed it here 12 millimeter. You can assume it 10 or you can assume it 8. It doesn't matter. So the filing here, it is 10 millimeter, not 12. This is by mistake. So it is 10 millimeters. Now let's get the effective depth. Effective depth equals H, which is calculated at the beginning. So minus cover, minus diameter of the link, minus the diameter of the bar divided by 2. So let's get the values here. So the result here will be 555 millimeter. Okay, so from the initial proportioning stage, we got all dimensions, H, B, and the effective depth of the beam. And we can conclude that in this figure, this is the slab given 175, and this is the total height, the width is 250, and the effective depth is 555. Once we finish the first step, which is the initial proportioning, let's go to calculating loads, and this is the most important part in this video. We will learn together how to calculate loads, transfer loads from slabs to beams. It was required from many of the viewers. They asked to have a video showing that. So let's learn together how to do that. First of all, we have to calculate slab loads. Okay, slab loads, as we learned this from slabs, you can check my videos on slabs, one way and two way slabs. The self weight of the slab equals the height of the slab multiplied by the density. The height is 175 millimeter. Let's put it in meter, multiplied by the density of reinforced concrete. So this will be the value. And also we have finishes load 1.5. It is given. So let's get it also. We can also, the slab live load is given at 3 kilonewton per meter square. So now we can get the ultimate load. Ultimate load, or N or W ultimate, equals 1.4 dead load multiplied plus 1.6 live load. This is according to BS code. If you are using a different code, of course, you have different coefficients here, but it is the same concept. So 1.4 multiplied by the dead load, 4.2 plus 1.5, then plus 1.6 multiplied by the live load. So the resultant here is 12.78 kilonewton per meter square. And as I told you in my previous videos, that the normal range of the ultimate load on the slab ranging in 10 and 15, 10 and 20 kilonewton per meter square based on the live load and the self weight thickness of the slab and so on. But a regular or normal range is between 10 and 15 kilonewton per meter square. So this is a normal weight, or W ultimate, or ultimate load on the slab. Now let's see together how to transfer the load from the slab into the beam, which is B1 here, which is similar to this beam. These are typical beams, the same. So to design or to get the load on these beams, we have to see the area loaded from the slab. So for the first span of the beam, it is supporting the trapezoidal load from this part of the slab, and also the trapezoidal load at the bottom side here. So the total area supported on this beam from the slab, it is A1 plus A1. 2A1. So the area of A1 to get it equals to what area of a trapezoid? The trapezoid area equals to the average of the two lengths multiplied by the height. So this length was given as 7 meters. This length is 7 minus 5, so it is 2 meters. So we can say 7 plus 2 divided by 2, we get the average of the two values multiplied by the height, which is the short length divided by 2.5. This will give us an area of 11.25 meters square. So the area of one trapezoid here is 11.25 meters square. Also here, the slab here, this is slab A2 and A2, because the slab here is 5 by 2 meters, 2 meters by 5 meters. So it is one way. One way we divide it from in the long direction here, this short part, half of the load here will go to this beam, half of the load will go to the other beam. The important for me here, that the load going to this beam, because this beam is supported on the cantilever. So we can get this area two. Area two is easy to define. 5 meters here, so this height is 2.5 multiplied by the half of the width here. This is 2 meters, so this is 1 meter multiplied by 2.5. So the area of A2 here is 2.5 meters. This area A2 and A2 will be loaded on this beam, or the area here will be as a concentrated load on the end of the cantilever, because this beam is supported on the cantilever. Of course, this the same area here will be supported on the column here. Other areas here will be supported in the columns, but as this will not affect the bending moment and shear force in the beam that we need to design, it is not important to include them. We need to include the areas that will result in bending moments on the beams. Okay, let's see also how to do that. So this area one and area two, we want to get the resultant force F1 will be as a trapezoidal load on the first span here. And these loads also will result in a concentrated load called F2 at the end of this cantilever. This is the beam and this is the cantilever. So at this end here, these areas will result in a concentrated load here. Okay, let's see how to do that. F1, how to calculate F1? F1 equals the area. So A1 plus A1, it means 2A1. 2A1 multiplied by the load from the slab. So 2A1 multiplied by N, 2 multiplied by A1, 11.25, multiplied by the load from the slab. This is area kilonewton. This is area is millimeter square multiplied by kilonewton per meter square. So the result here will be in kilonewton. Okay, don't forget that we neglected the self weight of the beam. If it is not neglected, it can be calculated, and I explained this in my previous videos. F1, we got the resultant here. This is the resultant, 287 kilonewton. And let's also get F2, it will be the same. It would be A2 plus A2, it means 2A2 multiplied by N, the load from the slab. So 2A2 multiplied by N, it means 2 multiplied by 2.5 meter square multiplied by the N. So again, this will be 63.9 kilonewton. So the force here is 287, the force here is 63.9. Once we finish this part, we are ready to start our calculations, structural analysis to get the bending moment on this beams. Under these loads, this will be the shape of the bending moment. Let's see how to calculate the maximum bending moments for that beam. First, the M negative here at this point, okay? Just take a section here and take a moment from the right side. So the moment here equals minus 63.9 multiplied by 2. It is a negative moment, it's going down. So minus 63.9 multiplied by 2, it will be 127.8 kilonewton, and it is a negative moment. Here, I choose to draw the negative moment at the bottom side, the positive moment at the top side, and many students and many scholars, they are doing the opposite. They draw the negative moment up and the positive moment down, and there is no difference in that case. It is still the same. This is a negative moment, and the value is 127.8 kilonewton meter. Now we need to get the maximum positive moment. Okay, we are going to do that in an easy way, an approximate way this time, just to save your time. So to get the positive moment, we know that under trapezoidal load, the maximum moment here, this value from that point to that point, equals, we can get it from this equation. We learned that a few minutes ago, okay? So to get the maximum moment here at the mid-span, what we need to do, we need to get the moment at this point, which is half of this value. So it is 127.8 divided by 2. Once I get this value, okay, to get the positive here, so you can say this value of the moment equals the total here, which is coming from this equation, minus 127.8 divided by 2. This will give us a moment at the mid-span. But of course, this is not the maximum. The maximum moment will be somehow shifted to the left side. Okay, if you want to get that, it is not that difficult, but it's going to take time. We have to get the X to get the zero shear. And once we get the zero, we can calculate the moment at this distance, which is the X. But of course, this is going to take some time, and I want to save your time. So let's get the M maximum positive, or M at the mid-span. In this case, it equals this equation minus the value here, which is the M at B divided by 2. So it will be like that. We just substitute with the values L and A, where the A is the 2.5 meters, and the L is 7 meters, and the F is known as 287.55. We did that. So we can calculate the values. The values are here. It will result in a bending moment 260.9 kilonewton meter at the mid-span, okay? Now, we are ready to make our design. We are going to start by designing the first span, first section, which is section what? At the mid-span. At this section, this is a positive moment. So the section here, the B web is 250, the effective depth is 555 millimeter, because we need these values. But this section, the moment is a positive moment. The tension is at the bottom. So therefore, the slab or the flange is under compression. So it should be designed as flanged section. And in this case, it will be as a T-section because it is an intermediate beam. So for T-section, we need to get the B flange. B flange, according to the BS code, equals the B web plus LZ over 5, which with where LZ here equals a factor multiplied by the span. In case of continuous beam, this factor is 0.7 according to the BS code. So we get the values here. This is the value of B flange is 1,230 millimeter. Now the famous equations, we have to calculate the K equals M over FCU B flange D square. This will result in a value 0.02. Of course, it is much lower than the 0.156. It means this will be a singly reinforced section. We don't need a compression steel for that section. So we have to calculate the Z over D. We can get it from this equation. It is greater than 0.95. In this case, the code is saying the maximum is 0.95. So we calculate the Z as 0.95 times D. This will result in this value. And then we can apply this to the last equation. Area steel equals M over 0.95 F yield times Z. This will result in a required steel of 1,132 millimeter square. Now we have the area, we can choose suitable diameter and suitable number of bars. So I choose the year 60-16. And of course, this will be a bottom reinforcement. Area provided of this 60-16 is 1,206 millimeter square. We got the reinforcement at the bottom at this section. Let's get the reinforcement at the top. Yes, we don't need compression steel, but we should use hangers. We should use some minimum steel at least to hang the stirrups. And for these hangers, it should be at least 20% of the AS provided of the tension steel. This resulted in this area. I choose here 2T16 at the top. Let's conclude that. So for the first section, the section number one, we found that we have at the bottom 6T16 and at the top 2T16. Once we finish the first section, section number one, now we can have a sketch of the section, cross section. You can find here, these are the six bottom bars. We put them in two rows because we cannot put them in one row because of the spacing. And at the top, we used 2T16 steel. We finished this one. We are going to repeat the work at section number two. Section number two, we have negative moment. So for negative moment, the tension will be up. And in this case, it should be designed as a rectangular section because the slab is under tension in this case. For rectangular section, we are going to use the B, not the B flange, the B web. So it will be 250. We are going to repeat the previous steps as in the second section, the flanged section, but except the B here, we use the B flange instead of the B web instead of the B flange. For rectangular section, we use the B web 250 millimeter. Again, we are going, this is less than 0.156 single reinforced section. We get the Z over D, it is 0.94. We use it as S, so this is the Z, and then we get the area steel. Now it is 560 millimeter square. Also, we choose suitable number and diameter. So 3T16 is provided 603 millimeter square. And for this, this will be a top reinforcement here, 3T16. And if you want to take a section at this section number two, this is showing that 3T16. We'll talk later about the bottom reinforcement when we go to the detailing. We finished the design. It was required from us here to also check for deflection. Let's check for deflection. For deflection, check. We check it at the maximum positive moment. Maximum positive moment. Even if the negative moment is higher, we check only at the maximum positive moment. So here we make our chip check using table 310. We get it from this equation, modification factor. So we need to get these factor Fs and M over BD square. So let's do that together. Let's get the M over BFD square because this is the flanged section. This is the value here. Also, we get FS equal to 2 over 3F yield multiplied by AS required divided by AS provided. These are the values that we designed. We got them when we designed section number one. And this is the stress in the steel reinforcement, 265 Newton per millimeter square. Let's substitute the values in the equation of M. We got the value of M equals 1.61, which is less than 2. It means this is fine. If it is greater than 2, just take it as 2, but it is an indication that the deflection will be very safe. You can reduce the size of the beam in such a case. Now it is less than 2. It's fine. Now let's check the basic span to depth ratio according to the code is 20.8 because this is could be assumed as continuous due to the presence of the cantilever. Now, the allowable span to depth ratio equals 20.8 multiplied by the M that we calculated, equals 33.5. And actual span to depth ratio is the 7,000 divided by 555. It is 12.6 less than 33. It means it is okay. I am going fast here just to save your time. But if you want to learn more about checking deflections, you can check our previous videos for slabs, for beams. It is repeated many times in my videos how to check for deflections in details. So the deflection here is safe. It is not required to check for or to design for shear in this video. I will do that in a coming video just to limit the time. And now we need to finish by showing the detailing of the reinforcement in elevation and also taking sections. So this is the elevation of the beam. We have a span and a cantilever. This is the cross section of the beam showing all dimensions without reinforcement. So let's start by the bottom reinforcement. We have here 6T16. So I choose here to take 3 from the beginning to the end, even it will cover this bottom part here of the beam. And here 3T16 will be curtailed, means shorter just to save in the reinforcement. You don't need the whole reinforcement to go from the beginning to the end. So these are the 6T16. At the bottom, at the top here, we have hangers 2T16. I choose to put them from the beginning also to the end. And if you still remember at the section number two, we need 3 bars, T16. We already have 2, so we can add additional bar here. So the total number will be 2T16 plus 1. It means 3T16. Just we can finalize by taking section. The first section will be section number one. You can see that here we cut and 6 bars at the bottom, 6T16, and at the top 2T16. And in the section number two, we have 3 bars at the top and also 3 bars at the bottom. Of course, to complete the design of that one, you need to design for shear and to know also about the shear reinforcement. I already did that in video beams part 2 and beams part 3. You can check that. And I will do that also in upcoming video for the same beam. We'll design for shear together to see how to do that. This will be the end of our video today. Thank you for watching. If you like the video, just please click on likes. This will help to distribute the video with many other students and will make it more useful. Subscribe and click the bell to receive all new videos. Thank you for watching and goodbye.